Hello and welcome to Rush Hour. On today's edition of the show, we will be going over the NFL schedule, NHL headlines, and some suspension talk, NBA recaps with a slap in the face of the whole cold hard truth in Dallas. We might even get some Star Wars and superhero racks in it at the end. All right, boys, NFL schedule. What games are you looking forward to?
There are a bunch. I mean, week one, we got Titans and Bucks, which is a potential matchup of the top two number one overall picks, which will probably be Jameis Winston, Marcus Mariota, a good quarterback duel there. I don't think that the Titans will end up with Mariota in the draft, whether they trade it or pass on him. But we could end up with the top two picks there matching up in week one.
Yeah, my week one pick is Vikings at 49ers. As a Vikings fan, of course, week one is the most interesting game at first.
I'm also a Vikings fan, for the record.
Yes, and I did not agree with the points favor over the 49ers. What was it, 3 or 3.5?
It's 3.5 the 49ers are favored by.
As a team with a whole new system, new coach.
Yep.
No returning players. There's returning players, obviously, but you know, you lost Patrick Willis. Mm-hmm. All these defensive players, corners gone.
Corners are gone, defensive coordinator's gone. They had, obviously, they lost Patrick Willis, and then they lost his replacement, too, in Chris Borland.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of turnover there for the 49ers. I think it's going to be a rough season for them. And I don't really understand why the Vikings are, I mean, because I get that the 49ers are at home, but I think the Vikings are a better team than the 49ers. So
I'd
only have the 49ers as like a one-point favorite, maybe an even line.
Well, I want to jump to week two when the Cowboys are in Philly. This will be DeMarco Murray's first attempt at some revenge against his former team.
That'll be interesting.
It will be. You know, I don't know if he's going to have the same season as he did last year since Dallas's O-line was absolutely incredible last year. So I know he's mad about the whole situation, so I think he'll have a good game that week, but probably not the same season as last year.
I agree with that.
I also have another game in week two, and it's the Seahawks at Packers.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
NFC championship.
NFC championship game and the most controversial call in NFL history. One of them, we could say. So,
we had two last year.
You know, you could say it's going to be a very hyped game between the teams and a big impact on the schedule already because one team of those two super teams could have a devastating loss.
Yeah.
Well, they'll have to.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with a fan pick for myself here in week six. The Kansas City Chiefs travel here against the Minnesota Vikings. I am a Chiefs fan myself. Never seen them play. So I'm looking forward to it. Hopefully, not hopefully. They will pull off the W.
That's bold. That's a bold statement.
It's a bold statement, but it's going to be true.
Oh, sure it is. Okay. Another one, week 12, the Panthers at the Cowboys on Thanksgiving. This will be Greg Hardy's first game back from his 10-game suspension that just came down from the NFL. And what a coincidence it comes against his former team. So we'll see if he goes out for some revenge there. And
it's not a coincidence the NFL planned that.
Well, I don't know. I mean, 10 games is a pretty even number. It's not like they had some arbitrary number. But I don't know. You can think what you want about the NFL.
It's just kind of hard for you to get me to believe that he's going to come back anytime less or anytime more when he could just come back against his former team.
Uh-huh.
I think it was pretty much a setup.
So. Yeah, you think everything is set up, just like you think the NBA lottery is rigged, which is ridiculous.
No.
Let's not get into that now. Okay. Speaking of the NFL not doing good things, talk about the preseason, how the Minnesota Vikings have 5 preseason games. Drew, I know you feel strongly about this one.
It's so stupid. It makes absolutely no sense. If you're going to do anything with the preseason, you should shorten it to make players safer. They're always talking about player safety. They're even considering extending the regular season. If you're going to do that, you have to shorten the preseason because it's pointless. No one cares about it.
Do you think the Hall of Fame game's pointless then, pretty much?
No, I mean, it's fine. I'm fine with the Hall of Fame game, but I don't understand why we have to play a game in week one of the preseason like everybody else. Why can't we just have a bye so we play 4 games just like the rest of the league? It doesn't make any sense to me.
Or why don't they just push the Hall of Fame game back a week?
Yeah.
And make that our week one, except make it on a Thursday night, so it's like the opener.
Yeah, exactly. I hope for our 5th preseason game we hold open tryouts and just get a bunch of civilians and throw them out there for the Vikings because I just am sick of the preseason. I think this is a terrible idea.
I couldn't agree more.
My last pick is the Patriots at the Broncos in week 12. Peyton Manning versus Tom Brady. It's always in the most anticipated matchup over the years. Right now, Brady holds the series head-to-head lead at 11-5, and the playoff series is split at 2. So, I'm going to go with Brady in week 12.
Mm-hmm. All right, week 6, I also have a Patriots game. Patriots at Colts. Some betting sites actually have the Colts as the favorite to win the Super Bowl right now. I'm not sure if I agree with that, but it's going to be a great matchup either way, Luck versus Brady. And, I mean, there's nothing we have to say about the Pats. They're the defending Super Bowl champions, and they're good every year. So that's going to be a good game.
Anything else, Kyle? No, any last picks?
I agree with all your picks so far.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Let's get a little hockey action in here. Mix it up. Minnesota Wild shut out the St. Louis Blues here at the XL Energy Center Monday night in Game 3. Can't say the same for last night, but we'll get into that later. I thought, for the most part, well, actually, they did dominate the entire game. This was a perfect example of a total dominant in one game.
I could not agree more, but Mike Hill, head coach of the Minnesota Wild, refrained from saying dominance over and over in his press conference.
But he says that in every press conference. His team's never going to be perfect until they hoist the cup. So
yes. Going into Game 3, I expected the Wild to come out and perform incredibly physical and well in front of their home fans, and they did exactly that while maintaining their speed and skill. What I saw was the Wild beat the Blues 3-0 and outshooting them 23-17. And Devin Dubnyk, goaltender for the Minnesota Wild, picked up his first career postseason shutout. The Wild came to play, but between the whistles, and they would not get involved in extracurricular activities as much as the Blues wanted. As much as Steve Ott and Reeves wanted, they did not get involved in it at all, and that's what won them the game.
Yeah, Blues tried to get in their heads, but they just didn't get involved.
What I liked a lot is that the Minnesota Wild did so well on defense. Like you said, they only allowed 17 shots, and that's incredible, which forces – it doesn't force Dubnyk to have to be fantastic or do anything like that or stand on his head. St. Louis had one or two decent chances in the game, but that was about it. Minnesota did a great job of keeping the shots to the outside. They never really let them shoot in the middle of the ice, and that's what you want out of your team, night in and night out.
Oh, yeah. During the press conferences, I heard Zach Parise and Jason Pominville say how good the gap control and defense was. The defensemen did not give them any space, and don't give them space, they can't shoot the puck. So it's perfect. It's a definition of dominance in Game 3.
Going back on what you said between the whistles, Minnesota Wild forward Charlie Coyle called Steve Ott a non-factor and just said, just let him be out there. He's not going to get to us. I think this is very nice to hear because of the stuff he pulled at the end of Game 3 where he was cross-checking and going headhunting on Scandella and then tackled Spurgey there at the end. There's just no place for that, and we can talk about that here in a little bit with some other suspension-type deal that I would very much like to get into. But Game 3 was an all-out dominant performance, in my opinion, and last night was a complete 180 from that.
Yeah.
Where the Blues just dominated the Wild even more so.
Yeah.
Winning 6-1 and keeping the Wild to just 18 shots while they had 26.
Three goals in the first 10 minutes of the game.
Three goals on seven shot, the first seven shots.
And Devin Dubnyk is mortal, it turns out.
He's not first bad game.
Yeah, he said, quote, today after practice, the sun rose today. So
yeah.
It was the first time he gave up four or more goals since before the All-Star break when he got pulled against Detroit. In the Wild, I think it was a shootout or overtime loss. So he's only been pulled once and gave up four more goals once.
Yep.
So this was odd, but it's easier to move on than a 3-2 overtime loss because you know you lost the game when it's 4-1, 5-1. So I think the players will just put this one behind them and move on, especially Dubnyk.
Yeah, hopefully.
And you could tell the things that Minnesota was doing in Game 3, they were not doing in Game 4. They were letting St. Louis get to the middle of the ice. They were letting them take shots where they shouldn't take shots. Nothing was clicking.
Goaltending, the defensive zone was just sloppy.
Defense was off.
Everything. I mean, most notably, like,
Spurgeon's goal was nice, but that was the only problem. They scored 3 minutes later and squandered any amount of momentum in the XL Energy Center.
I mean, the Wild had consistent defensive breakdowns in their own zone, which just cannot happen. And they were puck chasing. We just got too caught up in that they're down 3-0 and have to pressure, and didn't play for their their system, which is play defense first, that creates offense. We're trying too hard to pinch and do all this and not getting our gaps right and just playing too aggressive and not the right way.
Well, on to a different game here. We're going to stray away from the Minnesota Wild. Game 5 tomorrow night back in St. Louis. But we have our first triple OT game of the NHL playoffs. The Chicago Blackhawks against the Nashville Predators. Chicago won that 3-2 in triple overtime. I actually did stay up to watch this entire game. I thought it was very fun to watch.
It ended after 1 a.m.
Yep, 1:15, I believe. Saad, his goal was to tie the game. It was very nice. It was set up beautifully. Drop pass into the middle of the ice, had the entire net to shoot at. And then Seabrook, his goal there, it was very nice as well. Screen in front of the net. I believe, my opinion, these guys, it's the third overtime, sixth period. Basically, it's their second hockey game of the night. Fatigue set in, just kind of couldn't get the guy out of the middle of the ice.
Yeah.
Perfect screen route out in front. You know, the rest is history.
Darling had 50 saves, I believe.
Yep, crazy. 50 saves. That's his second time with having over 40-plus saves in this series.
Scott Darling has just saved the Blackhawks so far. Like, he's been phenomenal for a rookie.
Yeah, just crazy for a guy to come in like that after being on the bench most of the year.
He had a good game. I'm not going to give him a ton of praise just because Chicago did their job in the game. They kept Nashville on the outside. They kept all the shots on, not in the middle of the ice. So when you're an NHL goalie, you're supposed to stop those and not give up any rebounds, and that's exactly what he did. So he did his job. I'm not going to give him high praise. He's a good goalie. He's helping Chicago in this series.
I mean, it's hard to take out or take over a spot of a Stanley Cup winning goaltender in court.
No, it is. I'll give you that, but I'm just saying it wasn't a spectacular job in this 3-overtime game.
50 saves.
Yeah, that's because all the shots were coming from the outside, though. You're supposed to save those shots.
Yeah.
The Blackhawks and the Predators traded blows back and forth in the first period. I would give Chicago the little bit of a win in the first overtime and then completely dominated the second overtime if it wasn't for Pekka absolutely standing on his head in the second overtime. Nashville could have won. Or, I'm sorry, Chicago could have won earlier. And then 60 seconds into the third overtime, Seabrook puts it home.
I just remember seeing that highlight, and it was just a lot of Seabrook goes right to the middle, and just a lot of players were just not quick enough to get over there, just like you said, based on the fatigue being at third overtime. It's not the first time Chicago's done that either. They did that last year against St. Louis.
No, correct. In 2012, again, they also won that game.
Mm-hmm.
You could tell these boys retired both teams. You know, after the whistle, they went and lined up. There was no extracurriculars. There was no shoving or anything. Mm-hmm. They were saving every ounce of energy, but when they were playing, they looked good. I didn't think anyone looked bad or tired, but it was a fun game to watch.
Yeah. What do you expect for game 4 tonight?
You know, Nashville hasn't had the best home record as of late. They lost 2 of their last 11 games in the regular season. I'm sorry, they lost 9 of their final 11 home games. And
you just can't do that going into the playoffs.
Yeah,
pretty much.
So I would like to see Nashville win just because my bracket has Chicago winning in 6, but Chicago very well could win it tonight.
Yeah.
This is their second multiple overtime loss in the series. I don't know how Nashville is feeling right now. Could be feeling pretty defeated, but so we'll see. It'll be a good game.
Obviously, both these teams are tied right now, so it probably won't be a huge factor in this series. But in the next series, do you think the winner of this one will be really gassed and probably have not as much of a chance?
I think it depends on who wins, because right now, if Chicago wins tonight, then they advance and they have the break, so they can recuperate from that. But if Nashville pushes this to 7, that's when the fatigue is going to set in, that, and especially if other games go to overtime, then it can go on. But if they win tonight, they can rest up in plenty of time, because there's probably going to be a game 7, probably between the Blues and the Wild.
Yeah, exactly.
So they're going to have a lot of days to rest up.
I could see Nashville getting fatigued. They're kind of a bigger team. But Chicago breaks you down with their speed and handles. And Chicago, they're not really a team that gets fatigued after a series, and I don't see that from them.
Yeah. Do you want to move on to the Rangers and Penguins?
Yeah, let's go for that one.
All right, in Game 3, I expected the Penguins to drop one of their two games at home in the first four games, and they already did that. The Rangers were just playing better than the Penguins, and the Penguins needed to find their game. Excuse me. Like they once had during the regular season. I think that the Rangers will win this series right now. And they did win Game 4, so that says something. Because I believe the Rangers will win due to the fact of their goalie tandem. Yes, Talbot has not played so far, but he did... excuse me, sorry. He did save their season when Lundqvist went down.
Yep.
So if Lundqvist does need to break one game, or he does go down, I think the Rangers are going to win this series and go on very far due to the fact of that goalie tandem.
Yeah. And while other goalies are getting tired in the postseason, they'll have two guys that they can rotate to keep them fresh.
Yes. Game 4, though, the Penguins did play well enough to win that game. They scored within the first 2 minutes. The game was 2-1, and it was an overtime loss. Penguins were playing very well in front of their home crowd, and I was expecting to split it, but they ended up losing Game 4 in OT and are now down 3-1 in the series. So
yep.
I don't think the Penguins are going to come back from this at all. Game 5 probably will be the last game.
Yep.
On the brink of elimination, the Ottawa Senators pulled off a 1-0 overtime win last night against the Montreal Canadiens.
Yeah, they did. Senators, Craig Anderson went out there as goaltender. Played very well. I saw some of the saves on some breakaways from some of the Canadians. Stood right in there going spread eagle down. Made some great pad saves. Craig Anderson won in that game, I think. His goaltending was phenomenal.
Yep.
I'm glad to see that the Senators were not swept. I still think the Canadians will win the series. Oh, I don't think it's coming back to 7.
Uh-huh.
I think Canadians will win it at home.
We're not going to have a repeat of LA and San Jose last year.
And speaking of brink of elimination, let's talk about the Jets and the Ducks.
We do have a sweep.
I did not expect this at all.
Neither did I.
The Winnipeg Jets were swept last night by the Anaheim Ducks in a 5-2 victory. I read a stat this morning that said the Ducks only led for 38 minutes this entire series.
And going into Game 4, they only led for 11 minutes.
Yep.
For the first three games, which is just...
Something could be said that this was the most one-sided series win in NHL history for a team that had only been leading 38 minutes.
Yeah. The third periods were one-sided. Other than that, it was pretty good
series. Late third period, too.
Yeah, I was really expecting the Jets to come out and win this game. I mean, their backs were against the wall. I was hoping they'd have a better sense of urgency. They have one of the best home ice advantages in the league.
Oh, hands down. I didn't expect them to lose at home.
Yeah.
I said it multiple times. I'm like, I don't think the Ducks will win at the MTS Center, and they found a way.
Yeah, and then, I mean, like Rush was saying, the Jets had actually been leading the games for the majority of this series, so I thought they had played just as well, if not better, as Anaheim. But, I mean,
they personally, just I think the Jets outplayed the Ducks for most of the games,
yeah.
Obviously, based
yeah.
on the lead. This series, in actuality, should be 3-1 in favor of the Jets.
Yep.
But the Ducks found a way. Like Austin likes to say, it's all about what the final score is.
I do like to say that because at the end of the day, they found a way to score in crunch time. And that's the resiliency of this Ducks team. It's very high and it's very impressive. You don't really see that. They come from behind in every single game except for Game 4.
To come from behind
it doesn't matter. They scored goals when they needed to score goals. That is a trait of a winning hockey team.
The trait of a winning hockey team is dominating games and actually
yes, not having to come back.
But the resiliency for this hockey team to come back and win for three straight games, it doesn't matter. They still scored the goals. It's the final score.
God.
Minnesota did that to Nashville the second to last game of the season. They've done it several times before. We're not a dominating team.
I know, but still, you have the record for the most third period comebacks in the regular season. That shows something that you don't dominate
games. It shows that they're resilient. They don't lose.
No, it shows that they're overrated, and the season is a fluke. Just like the past two seasons when they were among the lead leaders in points, and then they lost early in the playoffs.
You guys can say what they want, but Maybe their third period is where they feel comfortable. If
right.
This shows that they're comfortable being down, they can still come back and win the game. That's what I see out
but
of this.
But with their roster, they should not have to be down.
Yeah. That.
You can say that for anyone's roster.
You have Corey Perry, Ryan Getzlaf, Ryan Kesler, Matt Pileski. List goes on and on. That team, on paper, should not have to come back every single game.
Yeah,
in this third period.
I don't care what you two say. It's 3 unanswered goals in game one for a 4-2 win. They scored in the final 2 minutes of game two, or game three, to tie it. You know?
Yeah, I get it. They won the game. But
you guys
still,
can think they're overrated, but...
I mean, we can also say that the Jets aren't clutch and they're able to hold it. But still, it's like, if this series was to be replayed, I think it would be 3-1 Jets.
I agree. What happens when the Ducks play too poorly in the first two periods and they're down 3-0 in the third period? They're not going to be able to come back.
They were.
You don't know that Chicago did that against Nashville.
That's a different team.
Exactly.
But it can happen.
That's one game.
You can't say that based off that. Chicago did it.
But it can happen.
Yeah, it can happen. The Wild got 6 goals in the third period. How often does that happen?
Yeah.
Like, Wild did it in 2014. That obviously means that any team can get 6 goals in a period.
Yeah.
Like, you can't say that.
I don't know why you guys are trashing the Ducks so much.
We've said the worst division in the league.
Yes.
They're overrated.
They've come back to win. They
come
don't
back.
Lose, though.
Right,
doesn't matter.
We'll see what happens in the next series. We can move on from this one. As of now.
All right.
Flames Canucks. Let's move on to that one. That is the definition of classic playoff hockey. There was a line brawl at one point in one of the games. The fans started fighting after the games in Vancouver. Classic Vancouver rioting.
Right.
But, you know, this game is just two Canadian teams that hate each other, and it's great to watch.
Yeah, I love it.
It's a much different game than what we're seeing with Wild, Blues, Blackhawks, and all those teams where it's speed trying to do this. These two teams, there's constantly throwing punches, big hits, just physicality.
Yep.
And it's a nice difference to see. It's classic hockey. What do you think about this series so far, Rush?
I enjoy it. You know, it's good old-fashioned Canadian hockey. I especially like it when the two teams don't like each other. It just makes for a good show.
Yep.
Do you think the Flames will win and get this series done? Because they're up 3-1.
Yeah, probably.
You think they win in 5?
That'd be surprising, because they really struggled at the start of the year, didn't they?
Well, I bet you they take it in 6, not in 5.
Really? In 6? I think that the Flames win this series and then lose next round.
Mm-hmm.
I've said it before. They can't keep playing this way of being outshot and just having high percentage.
Are they going to play the Ducks in the next round if they win? Do you know?
They'll play the Ducks.
Oh, will they?
They'll play the Ducks.
Oh, the two flukiest teams in the league. How about it?
I should make up a good matchup for you two boys.
Yeah.
Let's talk some suspensions, even though there haven't been any, which is the problem right now, in my opinion.
Who do you want to talk about first, Byfuglien or...
Yes, I would like to talk about Dustin Byfuglien first.
Winnipeg Jets.
Winnipeg aside, that what he did to Corey Perry was not all right, and I think it's deserving of a one-game suspension at least. I mean, what else has to happen? What he did was the Ducks had literally just scored, and... Again, this is after the whistle. Dustin Byfuglien takes the back of his head and throws him down onto the ice. Only gets a 2-minute penalty for that. If you remember, about 3 weeks ago, he cross-checked New York Rangers player pretty much in the back of the head. Got 4 games for that.
Mm-hmm.
The NHL preaches for their reason to give suspensions is repeat offenders. Repeat offenders, you know.
In contact to the head.
So I understand it's playoff hockey here, but you got to protect your players at some point. You know, PK Subban, he had that slash, but it gets made up because he was thrown out of the game right away.
Yep.
So there's basically his one game suspension, and that was also during the play. A lot can happen during the play, but this was after the whistle. That's what it basically comes down to for me. You know, Matt Cook, he got 6 games last year for the whole sticking his leg out situation.
Against Tyson Barrie and the Avs.
And why did he get 6 games? Because he's
a repeat
offender. So.
I think Byfuglien should have been suspended for a game or two for that. But there's also playoff hockey, and that's what happens. If you're going to suspend Bufflin for that, the Flames and Canucks, a lot of those players should be suspended for the stuff that happens after the whistle. They just started... They had a five-minute fight, Dave Englund, and a Canuck player had a five-minute fight pretty much, and all the other players did because they skated towards the goalie. And just a fight broke out for 5 minutes. So, if you're going to suspend Bufflin for being angry that Perry just scored and throws neck, I get it's from the neck and it's bad. He should probably be suspended, but you have to look at what happens with the Flames and Canucks then.
Well, the NHL needs to get something together then.
So you think they should just be kind of softer?
Well, no, I'm not saying soft, but like you said, it's head contact.
Okay, so I was punching someone in the face.
Well, the Flames-Canucks series, you can't suspend everyone.
No, I know, but if you're going to suspend players for after-the-play whistle stuff of contact to the head, you have to look at that game.
Yeah.
There's a big difference between punching someone in the face, which is what all these teams do after the whistle, regular season or postseason. But Bufflin, he took the back of his head and threw him down onto the ice.
It was a cheap shot.
It was a cheap shot. I agree with that, but I'm just saying you can't really just forget about what's happening over there in the West.
And I don't... I'm not saying that they are.
Okay.
There's a difference between punching when they're both engaged. Yeah. Corey Perry was a defenseless player.
Exactly.
His back was turned to Dustin Bufflin.
All right.
And that's my whole deal on it. It's, you gotta protect your players.
What about Steve Ott?
Steve Ott, he's the new public enemy in Minnesota.
Yeah.
It was Bertuzzi. Bertuzzi? Yes. Bertuzzi a long time ago with San Jose. There's always one player that the Wild fans love to hate. I was at game 3, and as he was going down the stairs, people were still chanting, "You suck, Ott." So,
explain what Ott did.
Okay, so what Ott did was, with a minute left in the game, they are losing 3-0. This isn't after a player scores or something like what happened with Bufflin. This is a minute left in the game. They're losing. Ott's frustrated. He cross-checks Scandella. A penalty is called, but the whistle has not been called yet. Okay, so then he goes over and hits Scandella again. Well, there's the delayed penalty.
Yep.
Scandella doesn't respond. He's not getting engaged, anything. Jared Spurgeon comes over and just like, doesn't get in his face. He's just skating over and goes, "What are you doing, Ott?" Turns around and tackles Spurgeon. And then what did Dubnyk say?
Dubnyk, he actually sprinted out of his net saying, "I saw Ott's hand over Spurgeon's face, and I could tell that he was moving his hand up and down, basically kind of clawing at him, at his mouth and his eyes." And this is not the first time Steve Ott has done something like this. In 2009, Steve Ott was actually suspended indefinitely for eye gouging at the end of a fight, also at the end of a game. Yeah, and there's a repeat offense, and he played in game 4.
Steve Ott should be suspended for that.
That was 6 years ago, and I understand, you know, the NHL's got the whole clean slate deal or whatnot.
I mean, if you think about it, he got a 2-minute minor and a 10-minute game misconduct with a minute left, so it means nothing.
Correct.
Somehow that 10 minutes should be able to carry over, and that's also a kick out, so he should have been kicked out of the game for game 4.
Yes.
Or if you get, if there's less than a minute left and you get a 10-minute major, that should carry over somehow.
Yeah.
Or else they're just going to allow players to do what Ott's doing if they're frustrated in a playoff game or something with a minute left. It's just unacceptable.
Mm-hmm.
I think the NHL should look at and what's going on right now and look at suspensions. I'm not saying they have to hand out suspensions for a punch in the face, but they need to protect their players.
Couldn't agree more.
All right, off of the NHL topic, let's go to some NBA. What do you got for Golden State and New Orleans, Drew?
Well,
game 2.
You know, yeah, there was a difference between this one and game 1. The scores look similar. This one was 97-87 in favor of the Warriors. But the biggest difference was Anthony Davis was aggressive from the tip. He had 11 points, a couple steals in the first quarter after really struggling in the first three quarters of game 1. And really, the Pelicans came out and caught the Warriors off guard, I thought. The Pelicans had a 14-0 run in the first quarter, and at the end of that quarter, it was 28-17 in favor of New Orleans. I really liked what I saw out of Eric Gordon with Drew Holiday out for the game. Eric Gordon came out and also put up 11 points in the first quarter, so that was huge. And the Warriors' offense wasn't as crisp as usual at the start. They had 6 turnovers in the first quarter and only shot 30% from the field. But you knew that wasn't going to last because the Warriors are so good and they're so dominant. Their bench came in. Leandro Barbosa, Maurice Spates, Andre Iguodala were huge, set the tone early in the second quarter. It was just a total 180 from what was happening in the first, 76% from the field in the second quarter, and they scored 38 points and took the lead from the Pelicans.
Yeah, bench production was a lot better, which is what Steve Kerr said needed to happen.
Yep.
Of course it happened.
Yeah, but New Orleans actually did hang around pretty impressively. I like what I saw from them. But then at the end, Klay Thompson just took over in the fourth quarter, 14 points in that quarter. And Golden State ended up winning by double digits. And that is huge for the Warriors. They need Klay Thompson to be special if they want to win the championship. He's struggled in the past two playoffs. His PER was around 10 for those playoffs, which is below average for the NBA. And we know Klay Thompson is an above-average NBA player, so they need him to step up.
Golden State held New Orleans Pelicans only 35 second-half points, yep. And Steph Curry proceeded to go off the whole Steph Curry don't worry. So.
Yep, and then I really want to draw a parallel here. Back in 2010, the Lakers and the Thunder played in the first round, and the Lakers were the 1 seed and the Thunder were the 8 seed, just like this series. And OKC took it to 6 games and played surprisingly well and did much better than anyone thought they would be. They thought they would do. It felt like a passing of the torch, kind of, from the Lakers to the Thunder as the new dominant team in the Western Conference. And then we all know what happened next. The Thunder made it to the finals in the next season, and then they were perennially a really good playoff team for the past 4 years, and they still are. So this isn't exactly the same. I mean, the Warriors are a really young team, whereas the Lakers were pretty old in that 2010 series, and they're going to be around for a while. But I do think it's similar with the Pelicans and the Thunder, because New Orleans is going to be a really good team really soon, with Anthony Davis especially. And then the Pelicans are going to have cap space this offseason. Omar Asik is coming off the books. He was actually the highest paid player on the team this year, which is crazy to think. So he's gone. They're going to have the cap is going to shoot up next year with the new TV deal for the league. So this could be a potential DeAndre Jordan destination, and they could get some help on the wing. They're going to be really good in the future. So I like what's going on in New Orleans.
Game 2, Boston Celtics versus the Cleveland Cavaliers. Cleveland goes up 2-0 in this series, 99-91 win for LeBron James and his Cavaliers.
Yep, the Celtics have proven in these first two games that they can put up a fight, but ultimately they just don't have enough talent on the defensive end to keep up with Cleveland's big three. They pulled to within 2 points in the fourth quarter, and it seems like whenever Boston makes a run, it's Isaiah Thomas running the show because he's just a spark plug. So they hung around all game, but then in the fourth, Kyrie and LeBron just put it away. Kyrie and LeBron actually scored all 24 of the Cavaliers' points in the fourth quarter. And it was a vintage LeBron game. We saw him just like old school LeBron, 30 points, 9 rebounds, 7 assists. He couldn't be stopped at the end. And he was just incredible in this game, really put the team on his back.
Like you mentioned last show, they tried to get Kevin Love into the game right away, which they did. He hit the first shot of the game with that three-pointer.
Yep.
So that was good to see. They're incorporating him. And then LeBron with that half-court oop to Kevin Love from behind the back. That was pretty.
That was awesome. But Kevin Love didn't play down the stretch yet again. We saw that some in the regular season. He just can't defend anyone in the pick and roll. And Isaiah Thomas was eating him up there. And so they went with Tristan Thompson instead. And that ended up working out pretty well for him. They won the game.
The Milwaukee Bucks and the Chicago Bulls. The Bulls go up 2-0 in this series. 91-82 win for the Bulls.
Yeah, this game was really ugly at the start, just like everyone expected this series to be. 27 points combined in the first quarter. And this game actually got really intense and pretty chippy. John Henson ran into Aaron Brooks and then stood over him for a couple seconds. That led to 4 technical fouls when there was a skirmish between the two teams.
Yeah, Mirotić was getting in on that too.
Yeah, exactly. Later in the game, Zaza Pachulia and Nikola Mirotić had a little European battle over there. And Mirotić actually injured his knee, which could
be big. Yeah, he's out for the next game.
Yeah, that is going to be big. He's really been a revelation for them this season. And whenever their offense stagnates, it seems like he can come in and provide a spark for them. So that's going to be big if their offense isn't as good in Game 3. How about Jimmy Butler, though? 27 points in Game 1, 31 in Game 2. He was a huge breakout early in the season, but he tailed off a little bit as he got banged up over the course of the season. But, I mean, he's just been incredible in these first two games.
I can tell you right now, this man is going to get paid in the offseason.
Yes, it's a really awesome story because this guy was homeless for a period in his childhood. He didn't get a scholarship offer until after he played a year in junior college. And now he's the leader of the Chicago Bulls team, and he's about to be very rich this offseason. So it's awesome to see him doing that. He was actually getting MVP chants in Chicago, which I thought was funny. I like when home crowds chant for their team's best player because everyone thinks their guy's the MVP.
It's good for Chicago to have another guy to go to besides Derrick Rose because when the Bulls have had Derrick Rose in the playoffs. Usually he's your guy who's taking your late game shots. Yeah. They were just feeding him back in 2011 down the stretch. Yeah. And now they got Jimmy Butler. They can go to even Pau Gasol sometimes.
Actually, if you remember back to 2011, what swung that series was LeBron guarding Rose down the stretch.
Correct.
And he just took him out of the game, and the Bulls didn't have any other threats. So the Heat easily took that series after LeBron shut down Rose. Speaking of Derrick Rose, he wasn't as explosive as he was in Game 1. It wasn't as encouraging, but he did a great job distributing the ball. He had 9 assists and really got the offense flowing. And then talking about the Bucks a little bit, I want to mention Chris Middleton, because that dude's a really good role player, and he's probably going to get paid this offseason too. He's the best player on the Bucks, in my opinion. He's 8th in the NBA in real plus-minus this year, which tries to quantify. It's kind of a catch-all stat. I don't think he's a top 10 player in the league, but he's really solid. He has a good future as an elite 3 and D guy, so shoot the 3 and D up on the perimeter. I really think if he was on a championship caliber team, he could be the third best player for a team like that, and they'd be able to win it all. He's one of those guys where if he was on the Spurs, I feel like he'd be, one of the most identifiable players in the NBA.
Absolutely. On to game 2 of the Washington Wizards and the Toronto Raptors. Washington takes this game 117-106, shooting 53% from the field for this win.
Yep, Raptors got out to a quick start, as I expected them to, because their backs were against the wall. 12-2 lead during the first quarter, and it looked like that sense of urgency was there, but then they just fell apart. I mean, their Swiss cheese defense was exposed in this game. This season, they were 26th in defensive rating. And as you mentioned, they allowed the Wizards to shoot 53% in this game, 48% from three. More of the same on the glass. In game 1, Washington out-rebounded the Raptors 64-48. And in game 2, Washington 45 rebounds and the Raptors only 28.
Correct. Free throws in this game were kind of an issue.
Yep.
Washington had 67% and Toronto 65% at 21 of 32.
Yeah, that's not impressive. That's like, I mean, we could do that.
Yeah, exactly.
Also, we talked a lot about Paul Pierce on the last show and how he was great playing the power forward for the Wizards. He was doing that again. He wasn't as successful. He only had 10 points. But what that really does is with him playing the four and bringing out the power forward out to the perimeter, it opens up the lane for John Wall to slash, do those driving kicks that he's so good at. And John Wall, 26 points, 17 assists in this game. And Bradley Beal, his backcourt mate, 28 points himself. Huge bounce back after game 1 when they only shot 11 of 41 from the field. And in this game, they were just incredible. So, awesome for them.
It was better than game 1, which is good to see.
Yeah, and it's really sad to see the Raptors lay an egg like this. Those fans deserve better. I mean, they're so great. That place is always rocking. And they have 20,000 fans inside the stadium, 20,000 fans right outside the stadium watching on a big screen. And they had such a promising start to the season. It really is disappointing for those fans to see them play so poorly. And Toronto's fighting history now. Teams are 18-3 when they win the first two games on the road, as the Wizards did. So I expect them to pull this series out pretty handily.
A little bit of controversy in Dallas with Rajon Rondo. They did drop their second game. Houston leads the series 2-0. Houston defeating the Mavericks 111-99.
Yep.
Rondo went down with a back injury, and those were air quotes for all of you who can't see.
Yeah, I don't buy it. He didn't play the last 23 minutes of game 2 because of that said back injury, according to Coach Rick Carlisle. But I think Rondo's just, he's toast there. After the game, Rick Carlisle actually said he doesn't expect Rondo to ever play again in a Mavericks uniform, which is something you never hear a coach.
For a team in the playoffs.
Exactly. It's crazy what's gone on there. I mean, I think he's just giving up on Rondo, and I don't think he's actually injured.
He's got a good defensive mind, and he's also big in playoff games. So it wasn't an awful trade.
Yeah, I mean, the trade was a failure. Let's be real about that. Their bench was depleted when they did it. They lost Brandon Wright, Jay Crowder. Rondo was terrible for the entire season, and their offense fell off a cliff after they acquired him. But I actually don't mind the gamble of trading for Rondo, because the chance that you get that playoff Rondo guy that we saw with the Boston Celtics is good enough that I would have done it. And also, I mean, if you look at their roster before Rondo, how far were they realistically going to go without him? Maybe the second round was their ceiling. With Rondo, I think they could have made it all the way to the finals if he had showed up and been like that guy in Boston. So, again, I don't mind the gamble. It didn't work out, but I'm okay with it.
And it's weird because Monte Ellis and Rondo got along perfectly. They were very close in the locker room, and for the most part, Tyson Chandler and Dirk Nowitzki, all three of them got along with Rondo.
The only thing was just Carlisle and Rondo, and I mean, it was just a classic player-coach power struggle, and I'll side with Carlisle on this one because Rondo hasn't been a very good basketball player for a couple of years now. He hasn't really been the same since he tore his ACL, and Rick Carlisle, I think, is one of the best five coaches in the NBA, so I'll side with him. And I hope the Mavericks keep Carlisle over Rondo this offseason.
Oh, absolutely. Rondo is, he's got to be as good as gone.
Yeah. Actually, talking about this game specifically, though, it was closer than the final score would suggest. It was a one-point game heading into the fourth quarter. And just like that Bulls-Bucks game, it got pretty chippy. Rondo versus Harden got into it. Tyson and Dwight got into it, too. But Dallas just couldn't protect the rim all game, and it really burned them in the fourth quarter. We have five alley-oops from Josh Smith to Dwight Howard alone. Just those two guys combined for five. 14 dunks by Houston was the most in a playoff game since 2001. And I'm really surprised that Tyson Chandler hasn't provided any rim protection whatsoever.
It could be his knee that was bothering him. I did read he wasn't even supposed to play that game, but toughed it out.
Also,
they did abuse him down there.
Other injuries for the Mavericks. Rondo with the back injury. We don't know if that's real or not. But also Chandler Parsons. He's out for the season now. And I know he's been struggling, but his absence is huge because Houston can now hide James Harden on defense. And what I mean by that is they can put him on Parsons' replacement, who isn't a threat offensively, so Harden doesn't have to expend any energy on the defensive end, save it all for offense, where he's so important for the Rockets, as we know. And so now the Rockets can throw Ariza on Monte Ellis and not worry about the Mavericks' other perimeter threats.
On to... pretty boring series here. The Atlanta Hawks actually squeaked out with a 5-point victory over the Brooklyn Nets to take a 2-0 series lead, 96-91.
Yeah, I know the Hawks are up 2-0, but these games have been closer than I expected. I don't know why they've been so close. I mean, Atlanta's offense just hasn't been as crisp as it was in the regular season, and it's not like Brooklyn is a great defensive team, so I don't know what the deal is. But I'm still optimistic about the Hawks. I still expect them to take this in four or five games. But they need to be a lot better if they want to make a deep playoff run. Paul Millsap was the story in this game for me. He ditched a shoulder pad that he had been wearing for a while because he said it was restricting his shooting motion. And came out in this game 7-11 from the field, 4-for-4 from 3, 19.7 rebounds, 2 blocks, and a plus 17 for the game, which was the best on the team. Also, Jarrett Jack was great for the Nets. I don't know where that came from, but he had 23 points on 13 shots. Off the bench, and he was a plus 9 for Brooklyn. And then Deron Williams had an open look to tie the game with about 5 seconds left. He just clanked it. I mean, that guy has no playoff chops or any desire, it seems like, as Paul Pierce said in his interview. And that guy, he's never going to win a championship in my eyes.
I would have to agree with you on that. Not much else to talk about in that series. Like we said, it's your 1-8. Mm-hmm. Not that interesting. Memphis Grizzlies take a 2-0 lead against the Portland Trail Blazers. Still injury-ridden, 97-82 final score.
Yep, pretty dominant again by the Grizzlies. The Blazers actually played pretty well in the first quarter, and Aldridge was amazing in the first quarter. But then in the second quarter, the Grizzlies went small, fronted him with Jeff Green, and brought a ton of help, usually from Tony Allen. And then Portland's offense just stagnated. Damian Lillard was bad again. Memphis outscored Portland by 13 points in the second quarter and then just coasted from there. On the perimeter, Damian Lillard, Nicholas Batum, and CJ McCollum were combined 7 of 30 from the field when guarded by Mike Conley, Courtney Lee, and Tony Allen. So that just shows you the advantage Memphis has on the perimeter, as well as in the front court where they have Randolph and Gasol.
We're going to go on to me and Drew's favorite series so far.
I mean, I love this series so much. I wish they would play it every round.
Honestly, this is the only series where each team holds a victory. All other series are at 2-0. This one is at 1-1.
Yeah.
The San Antonio Spurs take a 111-107 victory in the Staples Center last night in overtime.
Yep. So what was different from Game 1 and Game 2, I don't think it was anything with the Clippers. I think it was all Spurs. They were just faster. Their passing was better. It was like we saw in the finals last year. In Game 1, they only shot 40% on uncontested shots, and in Game 2, they were way better. So it was just really a really impressive performance from the Spurs with their backs against the wall. Tim Duncan, what can you say?
Father Time, logged 42 minutes.
He turns 39 in 3 days, and he is still dominating. 20, 28 points, 11 rebounds, 4 assists, 2 steals. He was the only Spur to play over 40 minutes, and all Clipper starters except Matt Barnes were over 40 minutes themselves. I just don't know how Duncan keeps doing it.
He made history last night, if you didn't know. Yep. It was his 100th 2010 playoff game, which only 3 other players in NBA history have accomplished. Can you name them?
We go Shaq.
There's one.
Kareem.
2.
Hakeem.
Karl Malone.
Oh, Malone.
Right. 2 for 3, not bad. Not bad.
All right.
Duncan said after the game, I played awful. He did, I wouldn't say he played awful. He missed 3 layups, and he had a couple of defensive meltdowns, which ended up in DeAndre Jordan dunks at the other end.
Are we talking about Tim Duncan here, the guy who dominated that game pretty much?
Yeah, he said, I'm not going to agree with what he said. Yeah,
he was phenomenal.
Yes.
And a similar thing happened with the Clippers power forward. Blake Griffin said the game was all on him after he had that turnover with 10 seconds left.
Yeah, what was that? Just lost the ball.
I don't know what happened, but if Blake Griffin hadn't been there, the Clippers would have lost this game by 15 or 20 points. So
triple-double for Blake Griffin.
So, yeah, 29 points, 12 boards, 11 assists, I think.
Yep.
So don't be so hard on yourself, Blake. You played pretty well. And then Kawhi Leonard was fantastic again. We're seeing that playoff Kawhi. He had a move on J.J. Redick.
Oh, my Lord.
That half spin just sent Redick to the deck. It was beautiful.
He went flying.
When he did that, I just started laughing. Yeah. This guy's going to be so good.
Kawhi Leonard actually won Defensive Player of the Year today.
Yeah, he did. I saw that.
Only player to do that since Jordan to be Finals MVP and then win Defensive Player of the Year the very next year.
And only perimeter player since Artest in 2004. We had a Patty Mills sighting. Patty Millions, as I like to call him. 18 points in 19 minutes. 2 clutch free throws at the end of regulation.
Those were huge.
Yep. Throwback to last year's finals when he was so good, knocking down shots off the bench.
He's not scared to take shots. And
no, you love to see it.
He had a nice little layup there in overtime where he almost got absolutely eaten by Blake Griffin and the rest of the Clippers team.
Yeah,
Patty but he got it off great. Just in time.
Yeah, here's why I'm worried if I'm a Clippers fan. They pretty much can't play any better, and the Spurs beat them still because the Spurs are just too good.
Hopefully every game is like this, and it goes to 7.
Yeah, this is the best series by far. I'm really enjoying it. We should mention Tony Parker. He only had 1 point and didn't make a shot from the field, and I think he's out. He might not be out, but he's struggling with a groin injury or something in his leg.
It was he had tightness in his right Achilles.
Right, yeah, Achilles, yeah. So we'll see what happens with him, but they need him, obviously. He's been a staple for them in their dynasty.
Do you know if anything was wrong with Manu last night after he fouled out? He went straight to the locker room.
I don't know. Yeah, I did see that. I was kind of curious why he didn't stay on the bench with his teammates, but maybe he was just so frustrated with himself that he wanted to get a quick shower.
It was a foul. It looked like he wanted to have back.
Mm-hmm. But Spurs still incredible.
It was impressive that Duncan, he actually had 5 fouls with about 3:30 left in the game, and he was able to play out the rest of the game.
Yeah, that's that old man just being a veteran, not making another dumb foul, just knows how to play with 5.
Could have been a hero no call from
Joey
Crawford.
Gosh, Joey Crawford.
Well, that's a lot of sports for today. Let's talk about maybe a couple of superheroes, maybe some Jedi.
Yeah,
upcoming movies
I wanted
that we're excited about.
I wanted to hear
just briefly here.
Because you are the biggest Star Wars fan I know.
I am.
And I know you also love a good superhero movie, Batman vs. Superman we got coming out.
And Avengers in a couple of days.
Yeah. Which one? We got 3 movies. Which one are you the most excited for?
I'm going to have to go Star Wars. I mean, this movie is going to gross. It's like $5 billion. I am looking so forward to this. You know, Luke Skywalker is the same age as Obi-Wan Kenobi was in.
Oh, it's crazy. And Harrison Ford's coming back, right?
I got chills after seeing the new trailer is just, amazing.
I'm kind of worried about it because part of the thing that was so awesome about Star Wars is the technology was so ahead of its
time. Correct, the difference.
And now looking back on it, it's kind of fun to see, I mean, what they considered amazing technology back then and special effects. So now with all these crazy movies we have right now, is it going to be such a novelty?
I don't know. I mean, I'm a kid at heart, and a new Star Wars movie is coming out. I'm trying not to focus on these special effects that were awful in the 70s and amazing today. So I think we have a great movie to look forward to.
Yeah.
I'm not stoked about Ben Affleck playing Batman.
I like Ben Affleck.
He's a good actor, but I can't see him as a superhero. Like, Daredevil?
Not
really?
That was a disaster. But he's not. We're not going to see a Christian Bale Batman again, so just be happy with Ben Affleck. I mean, you don't
I'll give him a shot. I mean, it's a Batman movie.
Yeah, I know I'm going to get yelled at for saying this, but I am not looking forward to any of those three movies.
What is wrong with you?
I'm not an Avengers fan. I don't want to see Ben Affleck as Batman. You know, my favorite Batman ones are obviously the Christian Bale, the Dark Knight series. Okay. Star Wars, I never got into as a kid, really. I've seen them now, and they're not that good, in my opinion. Wow. From seeing them without the nostalgia
We are losing viewers after the show. Yes,
just by saying...
We might be losing Kyle, too. He might not
be the show anymore. You know, my example is, have you seen The Goonies?
Yes,
that is the worst movie I've ever seen because I never saw it as a kid. I saw it as a 17-year-old. Like, oh, this movie is terrible with the acting and everything.
It's
still so
great. It's just fun to watch.
But this is the last time we talk about movies on the show.
Yeah, I'm just saying, the fact Star Wars, if I had to pick a three, I would see Star Wars out of it to see how much it's been advanced since then.
Yeah.
I haven't seen probably four or five of the Star Wars movies. No. So based off of the few I've seen, it's...
What kind of movies do you like?
You know... I don't know. I like movies that I find that are different. I don't know. I'm not into the whole superhero thing. I never have been.
That's fair, but
the only superhero movies I've liked are the Dark Knight series.
All right, well, Kyle's going to go home, watch a few movies, come back to life after he's been living under a rock his entire life.
Yeah.
Next show is on Monday. Thank you for joining us, guys. Any last-minute words? Kyle, don't talk.
Go wild.
Yeah, go wild. I'll say that too.
Game 5 tomorrow night. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Bye.